the human heart in pure and noble service. I wish it was that simple. The first time I saw a beating heart, I fell in love. That meticulous, intricate motion mesmerizes. The first time I saw it, I knew that I wanted to be a cardiologist. A cardiologist is there for you when you have a heart attack to unblock that coronary artery. They're there for you when your heart rhythm changes from this to this or even this. And a cardiologist is there for you when your heart muscle weakens like this. That's called heart failure. What a wonderful job. But before I found my passion, I was a first-year medical student, fun-loving, and I managed to sleep through every physiology lecture in my first semester. I almost failed my exams and realized I had to pull my socks up. And physiology is the science of how the body works. So I got a textbook, read it, learned the key points, and I managed to pass respectably after that. That summer, I worked in a heart physiology research lab, and the scientist in charge asked me what textbook I read. I told him, and he winced. He asked me, did I believe the theory of the heart and circulation in that book? Well, that came out of left field. I mean, I was pretty fond of that textbook by then. He said he didn't believe that theory because it was based on an experiment with a flaw in it, and it had to do with a collapsible tube. And lucky for you, we don't have time for me to tell you all about the hours I spent trying to figure out what on earth was wrong with that experiment. But in the end, I had an epiphany. Just because something's written in a textbook, it doesn't mean it's correct. There are more truths out there to be discovered. And that day, I wanted to become a truth seeker, a researcher. So I wanted to be a cardiologist and a researcher. I had to study for many years to do that in both fields, but I eventually reached that goal, and I was starting a research program in attacking the problem of patients who have heart muscle weakness. And I needed an issue to kickstart the research program, a great research idea. I was called to the clinic where we take care of patients with heart muscle problems, and I saw two patients. The first was a man with severe heart muscle weakening, and he was doing really well. In the next room was a man with very mild heart muscle weakening, and he was doing really poorly, and I didn't know what to do to help him. I went back to my office, and I couldn't stop thinking about that paradox, and I couldn't stop thinking about the patient who needed help. And it mixed with the research studies I was reading, and an idea took seed that became my research program. So a patient's needs triggered a question that no one had asked before. The patients that took part in that research program often said, "It might be too late for me, I know, but I'd like to help someone else." We were blessed with funding from charities and government agencies. I had wonderful collaborators. These were fellow researchers, research staff, and students. There was one person I chose not to collaborate with, and as the lead scientist, that was my call to make based on the needs of the group. That doctor was the hospital's director of the clinic where our patients were recruited for research. He began writing secret letters of complaint against me, and he enlisted his allies. Before I quite knew what had happened, I'd been accused of unsafe research practices, and the hospital took emergency action to ban me from the clinic where we did the research. I knew those allegations weren't true. I had the documentation to prove it, but the truth didn't seem to matter. The hospital hired outside lawyers to prosecute me and to protect the instigators who were not telling the truth. That encouraged more false allegations, and the hospital lawyers kept expanding their investigation. The hospital put the instigators in complete control of my working life. They made unreasonable demands, they provoked me, hoping that I would lash out, because if I did, they could say, "Look, you see, she's a problem." I had to show complete restraint every single day and hold it together while I was still looking after very sick patients. When that didn't work for them, their tactics became horrifying. They demanded I be sent to an inpatient psychiatric unit in another country. It wasn't a medical opinion. I wasn't anybody's patient. It was their demand. I had visions of one flew over the cuckoo's nest. I called the university provost, and he said to me, "You have to realize it's a power play." And he was right. Think about that. The university didn't protect me. It was my lawyer who said, "They'll have to send me there first. So if you end up there, I'll already be there and you don't have to worry." The hospital backed down and they never again mentioned this supposed severe mental illness. My story broke in the media early on, and the ranking senior doctor in the administration said that only patient safety issues would trigger this review, and she said it on national radio. At the three-year mark, I began waking up in the middle of the night, sitting bolt upright with the words 3 years ringing in my ears. My colleagues were building their careers and lives, and mine was crumbling. My lawyer wrote to the hospital board and told them about my loss and suffering as a result of this interminable investigation. He begged them to end it and just give me a hearing. And the letter back basically said, "We're not finished yet." An investigation that was supposed to take 4 weeks took 4 years. By that time, the research program had shut down. That research was lost. My staff had moved on to other careers. Many of the patients who took part in that research program died. I was so traumatized by the experience of being in this hostage-like situation, afraid of what I would be accused of every single day, that I had lost the capacity to think about the future. The hospital board came back and said that, in fact, there was no basis to take the action that had been taken, but instead of apologizing, they blamed it on me. They said that I was a doctor of bad character, and they publicized it on their website. My reputation was destroyed. I couldn't have got a job anywhere. I was completely trapped. My only chance to clear my name and maybe get back to research was to sue the hospital, which I did. And the hospital lawyers, they fought me at every turn, and they laughed about it to my face. The hospital kept the instigators in complete control of my working life during the 10 years it took to get it to court. And despite all that, many doctors would say I was lucky. I had tremendous support from other doctors. My coworkers bubble wrapped me with kindness. My patients made sure I knew I was appreciated. I had amazing lawyers, and I had amazing personal support. The media saw through the hospital spin and tried to get the truth out there. But I too had heard stories of doctors in situations like this who ended up losing everything. And I'd read the literature on workplace bullying, and the experts said, "You can't win, you have to get out," but I couldn't, I was trapped. So in my despair, early on, a colleague said to me, "If you have trained in both medicine and research, you have a very large toolkit of survival tools, and you should use it." So I dug deep, and with the help of colleagues, that's what I did. I knew that I needed a priority, all researchers do, and I knew that this battle would be largely won or lost in my own head. If I fell apart mentally, there was nothing my lawyers could do to save me. So I prioritized my mental well-being, and I knew that mission critical was having support at work. So I made sure I was an easy person to support. I never had dramas. I ensured that all conversations were focused on solutions. That required emotional discipline, but that is a lot easier than fighting this alone. But I had to do more than survive every day. I had to get out of this. So my colleagues and I looked at the psychology. The instigators didn't hide the pleasure that they took in the suffering I experienced. That's cruelty, so I treated the cruelty like a disease. I didn't feed it. So when I walked the corridors of the hospital, I tried to smile, and I always held my head high. After the instigators came some people who piled on. They were a few doctors, lawyers, hospital administrators, people who were professional and smart, and they knew that if they behaved irresponsibly in the workplace, there could be serious consequences to them. But they chose to take part even though they had no skin in the game. So why was that? What motivated them? Researchers comb the literature looking for clues, and I found this, the dark triad. It's a constellation of three personality traits that predicts workplace bullying. One of those is narcissism. Narcissists are drawn to the idea of judging others, and they're not fussy about the truth. So I could see how they'd be attracted to piling on. But narcissists have a serious weakness. They need admiration the way the rest of us need oxygen. So they're incredibly sensitive to criticism to the point that it sends them into a complete tailspin. So our theory was that however protected and powerful they were in the institution, if the media reported what they did in a poor light, then they would be devastated even if they weren't personally named. Then, if it wasn't attractive to pile on, then maybe they would rethink and walk away. So even though I'm a private person, when the media called, I cooperated. There's a difference between instigators and pilers on the one hand, and what ended up happening, which was the entire management and board of a healthcare authority working together to crush an innocent physician, which is what happened. Why did that happen? Well, we study the hospital the way you would study a disease. We looked at how my case was being handled and also how money flowed through the institution. And we found three key things. First of all, number one, there was a complete absence of supervision or accountability at every level of the institution. Number two, there was no attempt at truth-seeking at any level of the institution. So the first resulted in lack of authority breakdown, and the second resulted in a breakdown in the moral culture. And third, the hospital was happy to allow outside corporate lawyers free rein in the situation. So what was happening in these corporate law firms? Well, what happens in a law firm is secret. It's like a black box that you can't see into. But researchers are used to investigating black boxes. What we do is, when we have a situation that's effectively a black box you can't see into, we look at the change in the behavior of that black box in response to a change in the environment. So when the media reported that corporate lawyers were siphoning shocking amounts of money out of the healthcare budget into their law firms to persecute innocent physicians, their environment changed. So you would think that a responsible law firm would say, we'd better make sure we're acting in the public interest. Let's have a fresh set of eyes on this, make sure we're not offside. If that happened inside the black box, we would have seen a change in the behavior of the lawyers. That didn't happen. So studying the hospital and its lawyers taught us that leaving this situation to play itself out with this legal investigation would never get me out of this because those in power had no incentive to stop. So when senior physicians said, we'd like to do our own inquiry and the hospital balked, I said yes. When the Association for University Teachers said, we'd like to do an inquiry, and the hospital balked and threatened, I said yes. And when they finally relented to public pressure and ended the investigation, I launched a lawsuit. I had a very thorny relationship with hope during this time. Hope meant either the hospital would do the right thing or the hospital or somebody would get me out of this, and that led to devastating disappointments. I went from a person who was excited about the possibilities of tomorrow every day to a person who was afraid to hope. And that was a very difficult challenge to overcome. But I did it by working on my research plan. It's like an experiment. You set up the experiment not knowing what will come out of it, but if you set it up right, something good should happen. So when I had a chance to take part in on a nonprofit board, I took that so that I could be proud of something. When I had a chance to start a little clinic outside the usual hospital structure, this time for patients and families with genes that caused aneurysms, I jumped at it. And with my colleagues, we built a huge program with a national profile that won awards. And while I was building a life I could live with, all but one of the instigators left the province. So the trial came. And I don't have time to tell you about it, but I'll share with you one moment. I was on the witness stand. We had a spreadsheet that we'd asked for from the hospital, and they gave it to us in such tiny font, it wasn't legible. So my lawyer was drawing attention to it by asking me to read from it. A hospital lawyer with bad eyesight handed me his magnifying glass, and I dropped it. I immediately apologized. Afterwards, I wondered why on earth I had apologized to this man over something so trivial when he had wreaked such damage in my life. I thought about it again. What I did was natural. When you've done something you shouldn't, it's normal to apologize, to be worried about the damage. It's the sign of a normally formed character, and it's a sign of a conscience. And it's also the gulf between me, that lawyer, and all the people he represented. I had to fight the hardest to stop them changing the person that I was. The verdict came back. The jury found that the hospital had acted in bad faith and malice. That means that the stories they told about me were not honest mistakes, and the damage done was no accident. The Court of Appeal endorsed it. They pointed to all the evidence that showed that the bad faith extended through the entire institution from the instigators all the way up to the board. I had the largest damages award for personal suffering in Canadian legal history. So this beating heart took me on a scientific journey I never would have chosen. It should never have happened. But in the end, what I learned from research did help me to survive. All the way through this, people told me that when bullies have all the power, they always win. And it turns out that's not true. And I thought that was an idea worth sharing.